Hello everybody, my name is Dennis and you are watching Close to Algo Trading. In this video, we will see how with a few simple steps we can improve execution performance of a Python code more than in 2000 times. And in order for us to be not only interesting but also useful, we will perform all our manipulations using the example of a Monte Carlo simulation to calculate an expected maximum drawdown. First, let's start from the beginning and answer the question, what the maximum drawdown stands for, and how to calculate it. The maximum drawdown is an indicator of a downside risk of a specific time period. Normally, it's expressed in the percentage term and calculated by the following formula. To have a formula is very nice, but to see how we can calculate it with the real data is much better. Let's take 100-day closing prices of SPI. We can see here two drawdowns, and it looks like the second is a maximum one. We can try to make a group calculation here. Our high was about 212.1 and the dip was 204.4. Using the formula given earlier, we can calculate the maximum drawdown. It's around 2.3%. This result is not really accurate because we did assumption about the price level. Now let's calculate it using Python function. One of the possible Pythonic implementation could be like this. It looks very clean and short. The function calculates the maximum drawdown and we got result 3.5%. And this function takes about 16.3 microseconds, which is not really bad. But can we improve this timing without any fancy and complex things? Well, my answer is yes. And the most simple action that we can do is to use a Numba. Numba is an open source JIT compiler that translates a subset of Python and NumPy code into fast machine code. We can simply convert the Python code into the Numba just to add one comment above our function definition. But with the given function it will not work because the Numba doesn't know the accumulate maximum function. However, we can implement the calculation of a maximum drawdown without the accumulate function. Our new drawdown calculation can look like this. You may notice that we have a Numba decorator above the definition. With this implementation, Numba doesn't have any complaints and the execution takes only 4.8 microseconds. It is more than 3 times faster. Personally, I like this implementation much better because it describes a generic algorithm in a very simple way. So, we can calculate the maximum drawdown and it is 3.5% and let's call it historical maximum drawdown. Based on this risk metric, we can assume that if the market condition will remain the same, our maximum risk will be only 3.5%. But how we can trust the value which was calculated from only one specific observation? Maybe it is better to have few more observations from the similar situations? For sure, yes. And over here the Monte Carlo method comes to help us. Let's stay for a second and clarify what the Monte Carlo means. The essence of the method is as follows. The process is described by a mathematical model using a random variable generator. The model is repeatedly calculated. The probabilistic characteristics of the process under consideration are calculated based on the obtained data. In our case, the process describes a stock return series. The mathematical model is geometric Brownian motion. It is widely used in financial world to simulate stock prices. And finally, calculated characteristic is a maximum drawdown. In other words, we are going to generate many simulated price series and calculate the maximum drawdown on each of them. Then we are going to take average from all of these calculated drawdowns to estimate a maximum risk, which we can expect if the price area characteristic remains the same. Let's go quickly through some mathematical equations, just to have an idea what we will implement and calculate. We want to generate price time series, so the price in any point k can be calculated like this, where as k minus 1 is a previous price and r is a log return. And we represent return as a Brownian motion. It consists of two components, drift and diffusion. to calculate a drift, we need to have a mean and a standard deviation of a return. This value we are going to calculate from the historical price series. Drift is a constant and describes the direction. Diffusion is a random component. Let me say it's a noise. To calculate it, we will generate a random number from the normal distribution with the center equal to 0 and the standard deviation equal to 1. Then multiply it by the standard deviation which was calculated from our historical price series. Let's skip all the mathematical conclusions and just accept that if we have starting price as 0, we can generate any subsequent price in our price series using these equations. Where key is the price index of the subsequent price, the last element is the sum of all previous random numbers. Now, if you want to generate time series with n elements, we just need to calculate this equation n times. Well, at this point we are ready to generate new price series. What is still missing? It's historical price series characteristics. For the next steps, we will need start price, mean return and standard deviation. Let's calculate them. These calculated values we will use as input parameters for all our following calculations. And now we can implement a function which will generate any requested number of a new price series of any requested length. The first implementation can be straightforward with two loops. First one is needed for generation of the requested price series numbers, and the second one for generation a new time series of requested lengths. The second loop is an implementation of our Brownian motion process. In each iteration, we generate a random value and calculate cumulative sum of all previous random values. The result is stored into the variable v, which is used for diffusion calculation. You may also notice that we use index k to calculate a drift. Then we calculate new price using our equation and add this price to the price list, which contains all generated prices. When the second loop is done, we have one full generated price series, so we add this series to the resulting list. That's all. Now let's generate two new price series with the length of 100 prices. As a result, we got two possible ways of price development with the same characteristics that the historical price movement has in this time period. In the same way, we can generate 200 new prices. We already have all required components, and we can create a Monte Carlo simulation for the estimation of a possible maximum drawdown with our price series characteristics. For that, we just need to add calculation of the drawdown after generation of each new price series, and then take the mean of all our calculated drawdowns. Everything is done. Let's generate 10,000 price series and see what the real expected drawdown is. The value we got is 7.3%, which is more than 2 times higher than originally calculated drawdown from the historical data. It means our real risk might be 2 times higher. Well, I hope now you have an idea how a Monte Carlo simulation can help us and how to implement it. With a similar way, we can calculate other metrics, option prices, or even run tests of the trading strategies. But now go to the next topic, execution time and performance optimization. With our current solution, we have a small problem. The simulation which generates 10,000 different series takes on my machine about 8 seconds, and if I need to generate more, it could take forever. What we can do with it? We can wrap this code into the Numba and it will definitely help. But before we try it, let's see if we can do some improvements with the Python implementation itself. First, what we can do is to replace our call of random function in each iteration with the read operation. We can generate an array of required random values before the second loop, and then just read the value from the array. Read operation is for sure faster as function call. So this new version, let's name it V1, takes 3.5 seconds, which is 2 times faster than initial version V0. If we think a little and take a close look at our implementation, we will find that in the diffusion calculation, sigma is a constant and our variable V contains the cumulative sum of generated random values. The same situation we have with drift calculation. Here, key is a dynamic component, which is indexed from 1 to 100 as we generate 100 prices. With all this information, we can remove the second loop and use NumPy vectorize operation to calculate our price series. Let's call this version V2 and measure the calculation time. Wow, it takes less than a second, which is 26 times faster than initial version V0. Now, when we have a lot of fun with code improvements, let's check how our code will run if we convert it to Numba. For that, we just need to add a number decorator before the function definition. Once again, we are not trying to find the best implementation, we are trying to get improvements with the very simple steps. Well, we can see that all our three functions using Numba take fast the same execution time, and it is about 60 milliseconds. But what I can't expect that the vectorized implementation, version V2, will be the slowest one. The fastest version is the V1 and it runs 148 times faster than original implementations. Before we go to the next step, let me introduce one more implementation, which is very close to our original implementation with only few modifications. We split our Monte Carlo simulation into two functions. First one is computation function, which we wrap into the Numba. The second one contains initialization and call of our computation function. You may also notice that we generate random variables for all new price series at once, and we define the output array for our calculated drawdowns. In the computation function, we calculate our constant path of the drift only once. And also, we calculate the drawdown in the same loop where we generate prices, so we don't need to loop over all prices again for drawdown calculation. You will see how this implementation will be useful in the next steps. Also, the execution time of this version is more than 20% faster than we got with our best previous Numba implementation. The same implementation we can convert into the C++ and check how fast it is. C++ implementation runs 3 times faster than the same code in Python Numba, and it takes only about 16 milliseconds. But we are not going to stop here and ask, can we execute our code in Python even faster without some complex optimization techniques and beat the implementation in C++? We can try. If you have a GPU with CUDA cores, Numba provides a support of NVIDIA CUDA. Let's try to use it. To convert our implementation into the Numba CUDA code, we need to add CUDA JIT decorator. There is one more change needed. That is specific for the CUDA functionality. So, please check information on the official CUDA webpage to get more details about it. For us, it's important that we can execute our computation function in the CUDA kernels. We already prepare our computation functions. We also need to prepare our initialization. Here, we need to do a bit more. We need to define the number of threads and blocks. And also, we need to locate and transfer our NumPy array to the device for faster access. And to be able to call the CUDA computation function, we need to pass number of threads per blocks and block per bits as a parameter to this function. This code takes only about 29 milliseconds and is about 280 times faster than our initial version. Honestly, I am a bit confused here. Our C++ implementation is still faster. Maybe I did something wrong with the Numba. But let's check how long the same task takes with pure C++ CUDA implementation. The core function looks the same, and the full implementation you can find in the GitHub. Well, no surprises here. C++ CUDA implementation is much faster as a Numba CUDA implementation. So we still want to use Python and maybe get a similar speed as we got with C++ CUDA. We already did a great improvement with the very simple code changes. Let's do one more step toward execution with the speed of light in Python. To do the next step, we need to use the CuPy package. CuPy is NumPy compatible array library for GPU accelerated computation with Python. What we need to do Let's take our implementation of our computation function in the C++ and pass it into the raw kernel method of the CuPy library. The next we need to do the same preparation code as we did for Numba CUDA, but using CuPy methods. We define number of threads and blocks and call our computation kernel. The result is impressive. We can run our simulation in Python using all power of GPU, and our execution time is only 4 milliseconds, which is 5 times slower than pure C++ CUDA implementation, but fast 2000 times faster than our initial Python version. And all of this without any complicated improvements. Well, we did a great job. Let's do some conclusion. We may see that our Python initial version and the Python V3 version are taking too long, more than 7 seconds. Also, we have vectorized Python implementation V2, which takes only 219 milliseconds, which is not bad. If we leave in our graph only V2 version and remove all other pure Python implementation, we can get better view on the Python Numba results. Interesting that the all Numba versions have the very close execution time. However, V2 has slowest execution time and the version V3 the fastest. If we leave on our graph only the fastest results from all our implementation, we may see that the CuPy implementation is 70 times faster than our best pure Python implementation and in 7 times faster than Numba CUDA. Numba CUDA is a bit confusing here, looks like something is wrong, because the improvements from the normal Numba is not so great. But why we need to use Numba CUDA with all this specific time conversion if we can use the pure C implementation directly in Python code and get amazing execution time? Thank you for all who got to this part. As always, you can find all code in the GitHub. To run the code, you can use the Docker image file from the repo, or you can use official Rapids Docker image. That's everything for today, and see you in the next video. Bye!